We all make mistakes, and sometimes we are lucky enough to understand and learn from that mistakes. But this video is about prevention, because, you know, it's way cheaper. So, let's start to talk about some builds, from very low budget build to the high end. As you can see, I wrote here wrong, but why? It seems that we have nice components. A Ryzen 3 2200G, a Gigabyte AB350, 8GB of memory, a Western Digital 240GB, a nice chassis and a good PSU. But where is the error here? The error is exactly in the memory, because if you know or if you don't know, check my video about it. If we pair this system with slow memories, we are cutting the performance about 30-40%. So if we look this next build, the only change that I made, this memory kit that I'm doing as well a giveaway, so you should check it out. Back to our build, with this memory we can maximize the performance of this system, and if you know how to overclock this memory, you can reach up to 3200 C14 and make this build to run the latest game at medium detail. Another common mistake is to use only one stick of memory. By doing this, you are literally slashing in half the performance of this build. You can start with an 8GB in two stick and then to upgrade with a second kit later on for a total of 16GB. That is more than enough to do almost everything. Moving to the next build, here we have a system that is designed to be upgraded. We still have the Ryzen 3 2200G, but we have a B450 motherboard. For the memories, we have a kit of G-Skill Flare X 3200MHz C14. This is one of the best kits you can buy right now, for AMD and for Intel. The best thing about this kit is that once you enter in the BIOS, and you set the XMP or DOCP profile, you don't need to do anything else. You just set the memory and you can start installing your system. For the storage, I choose the Samsung 870 EVO 500GB, enough room to store all your games, and then if you need more space for your document or your archive, you can always add a second mechanical hard drive. For the chassis, an NZXT H500. A very nice chassis, very easy to install the components in it, and then as well with a good design. For the PSU, here we have to spend a couple of words. As you can see, this is not very expensive, but the Seasonic S12-2 is one of the best PSU in the market for a low budget. Very reliable, a workhorse, and enough power to do every future upgrade you may need. Choosing the right PSU is very important, because when you buy cheaper components, they stay silent until you are working on a project for 3 or 4 hours without saving your project, and they wait until you're almost done and then they die, because that's what the cheapest PSU do. Moving on to the next step, we have the same configuration but with an RX 570 card. With this video card and this processor, you can play the latest game at 1080p high quality. And then again, if you need another upgrade to do more multitasking, or if you need more CPU power, you can just swap the Ryzen 3 2200G with a Ryzen 5 2700. If you have more budget from the beginning, you can start with this configuration. 6 core, 12 threads, 16GB of DDR4 3200 C14, a Samsung M2, so PCI Express, faster than a normal SSD, an RX 570, the same NZXT H500i with some RGB, and the Seasonic Ultra Prime Titanium 650W. This is a very nice PSU. It costs more than the other, but this is a PSU that can literally stay with you for a decade. Why the 2700X? The X version is very useful when you don't know how to overclock it or simply just you don't want it, you are lazy, whatever. The 2600X is a CPU that basically overclocks itself. You just set the memory profile in the BIOS and then you can leave it as it is and you get the maximum performance that silicon can give you. Another important thing about the AMD builds is the stock cooler. The stock cooler is good enough to do whatever you want with the CPU, even overclocking. With Intel, well, I do not advise to leave the stock cooler on the Intel platform. If for whatever reason you don't want to buy an AMD CPU or an AMD system, we can also go to check what Intel and Nvidia have to offer. In this case, we have a Core i5-8400. This is a nice 6-core processor, is less multi-threaded than the AMD 2600, but these have very good single-core performance, and in games like World of Warcraft, is a very nice CPU. If you want to maintain a good level of noise, a good choice is to go with an aftermarket CPU cooler, like this Noctua or every Noctua. This specific cooler can give you nice performance at a reasonable price, and of course, low noise. For the motherboard, I chose the Strix Z370 because, in my experience, ASUS motherboard and Intel are very well developed and there's a lot of nice features, a very easy BIOS with some presets, and for who is interested in RGB, this is a very nice base to personalize your chassis as you want. Again, we have the Flare X 3200MHz C14. This is a good kit for every platform. You can run on Intel and even reach very high megahertz of overclocking. I personally run this kit with an Intel board and an 8700K at 4500MHz C19. This kit is selected with the best B die they can put on it. If you know how to do it with this kit, you can reach the speed of kit that costs as much as twice. For the GPU, here we have a GTX 1060 6GB. It's very similar to the RX 570. If you want to build a top tier system right now, it's not the best time. We all are waiting the new RTX 2080 from Nvidia, so I suggest you to wait at least a month and to see the review, my review, the review of others, and make up your mind before planning to build that system. We can take a look to this configuration, but as I said, it's better to wait a couple of weeks. Here we have an i7-8700K and an all-in-one liquid cooling. Same motherboard, same G-Skill Flare X kit, and in this case, a Samsung 970 EVO 1TB. For the graphics card, if you want a top tier system right now, the only choice, the best choice, is the 1080 Ti. But again, the best thing to do right now is to wait a couple of weeks. I'm going to review the 2080 and the 2080 Ti. So the best thing is to see a lot of review, and then once you have clear what is the performance versus the price and the benefit, then you can choose wisely. Again, same NZXT H500i and the Seasonic. If you need a system that is more multi-threaded, you can always change from the Intel 8700K to the AMD Ryzen 7 2700X. The components are more or less the same. I had to change the motherboard, and here we have a Gigabyte X470 Gaming 7 that I personally tested in a lot of videos that I made. And I can guarantee you, this motherboard is very solid. You can literally do anything you want, even 2407 rendering session. The VRM section is one of the best I saw. Again, if you don't want an Nvidia graphics card, you can always choose the RX Vega 64 and save a couple of hundreds. A good advantage of this graphics card is, of course, the price, but the price of the monitor that you can pair with it. A FreeSync monitor is at least 100, 150 or 200 less than the counterpart with G-Sync. And to me, this is a good plus. The idea about this video is to do a series every first week of the month, so to keep you updated, and then to give you my experience when I test some components on CPU, to be able to give you the right information if you need it. Don't forget that I'm trying to support everybody, just write a comment in the section below and I'll try to answer you as soon as possible. So, I hope you enjoy this session. Let me know as well if you think this is a good idea to put this recording video in the channel, and see you in the next one.